Good morning, everyone. I'm Jessica Lovell in for Chief Medical Officer Dr. Steve Stites. Today, we are here inside the Dulce Simons Jr. Family Broadcast Studio, and we are so glad you are joining us. Dr. Stites is back tomorrow, though. And with us in studio today is the Chair of Internal Medicine for the University of Kansas Medical Center, Dr. Matthias Salathe. Dr. Salathe is a pulmonologist, and he's going to update us on some current COVID-19 therapies. He's going to share his thoughts around COVID-19 vaccines as well. And you also may recognize him from his research involving the vaping robot. We are going to talk a little bit about COVID-19 and vaping as well today. In fact, vaping is also in the wheelhouse for Dr. Amanda Olinger. She is the Director of Pediatric Services at the University of Kansas Health System's Marillac campus. Dr. Olinger is very concerned about teenage habits, one in particular that could spread the novel coronavirus. So we're going to talk with her here in just a moment. But first, we have Dr. Dana Hawkinson joining us. And we know we started out the week on Monday with not very good numbers. We had four deaths here. Yeah. How are we doing as of this morning?
Yeah, they continue to look better. We're optimistic about that. So our numbers are down from a peak of 36 the last couple weeks, now down to 26, but only five of those in the ICU and three of those on the ventilator. So the less numbers, the better. And hopefully we can keep pushing that number down if we can keep decreasing the spread and everybody doing what they're supposed to be doing.
All right, following the rules. Thank you, Dr. Hawkinson. All right, so we want to jump into our conversation today. We have Dr. Salathe with us today. So glad you're here. Talk a little bit about how COVID-19 has impacted the work that you do. And is there anything that you wish you would have known back in March that would matter now?
Well, so the work that we do came to a complete halt in March, and everything shifted to COVID-19. I think that's a fair statement. Mm. All the research labs were closed, the clinical trials were closed, and we focused on COVID-19 treatments. Now, what do I wish I knew in March, what I know today? I mean, all of these facts that we know today are only possible because we started to treat patients with COVID-19. And not only that we treated patients with COVID-19, but we started to treat them according to protocols where we can actually learn what might work and what doesn't work. So I wished I knew this in March, but obviously without COVID-19, there is no way that we can actually know this for a fact. And so unfortunately, we always have to see patients first and then get the experience how to treat them. But I think the good news is no matter what disease, we're getting better at treating patients with these diseases. Even if we believe we don't do that much differently, there is a better outcome. And we have seen that in COVID-19 as well. And now we have many trials that at least assess some very good, some maybe not so good, but gives us indications where we might be with treatments and what we can really use.
Can you update us a little bit on where we are with trials and vaccines, just from your perspective? What are your thoughts?
Oh, now I'm going to in speculation. So we have some very good trials and some treatments. You know, we know that remdesivir in the correct setting might be helpful. We also know that dexamethasone, you know, a steroid, can be helpful in the right settings. There are multiple other trials still on the way that we're looking for what to do. We know a little bit more about whether we should put a person on a ventilator or not. And I think that thinking has changed with some of the developments. And so in the vaccine space, I'm an eternal optimist, I have to say. I think the modern vaccines that have been developed, they have actually benefited from some research that was done way before COVID-19 hit. It had to do with SARS, the first one, had to do with Ebola, but also with the common coronaviruses that are in the community. And the new developments, these are the mRNA vaccines and the viral vector vaccines. One is the Oxford and one is the NIH vaccine. They have published incredibly encouraging data, some in large numbers of people and some in less not large numbers, but still they're highly, highly, highly promising, including in some of the animal trials. So we're going into big phase 3 trials right now. And if everything goes well, I'm venturing out, right? by the end or the turn of the year, we might be able to really have vaccines ready to go.
Well, which we appreciate your optimism. We like to hear that. Don't tell us just what we want to hear, but we do like
no,
to hear it.
I do believe.
So I mean, that, yeah. But that is a question people have, Dr. Salathe. We get a lot of questions in every day, and you've heard this one before, of are we moving too fast? You know, we think of vaccines, it takes years to develop, and we're wanting something on the fast track. Is that a concern? What are your thoughts on that?
Well, I would turn this upside down. I think actually we're moving too slowly, and I don't mean that in the COVID-19 space. Had we developed vaccines in the coronavirus space that these vaccines were actually targeted for a long time and possibly funded that work better, we may already have vaccines. So had we shown the safety of these vaccines last year or 2 years ago, we just needed to actually put the coronavirus proteins in there or the expression of the coronavirus proteins, and we will be even faster. I think in the future, given that we are on a path of success, at least in my belief, and if that's really true, we will have even faster virus vaccines. So I'm not sure I answered that question correctly.
I think
it's upside down. But so far, you know, knock on wood, and I don't have wood here, but knock on wood, it is really very promising, and there are really no serious safety concerns that we can point out to, at least for now.
Yeah, no, that kind of kept it real. Do you have any thoughts on that?
Absolutely, Olinger? I agree. You know, we know that the NIH and the government is partnering with these companies, and certainly safety is the biggest factor, as well as efficacy, and so they are moving forward with that. The small trials that Dr. Salathe talked about do look like they are safe. And of course, even once the vaccines are rolled out to the masses, there will still be data collection to make sure that they are continually to be safe.
So. Of course. Okay. We want to get to Dr. Olinger in just one moment, but Dr. Salathe, I want to kind of switch over to...
I need to make a plug.
Yes, please.
By the way, for both remdesivir and for the NIH vaccine, 2KU alumni were deeply involved in the development of that. So KU has a part of that.
That's right. Good.
That's fantastic. Yeah. Thank you for sharing that. But another thing, we got something that you've been involved in, which is really cool, and that we were talking so much about before COVID hit, was your vaping robot. And a question we get a lot about vaping is, can COVID travel in a vape cloud? And what is your answer to that,
cigarette,
first of all?
Smoke cloud. We have said that no, it's not going to be very significant if there's any viral particles or viral RNA that is in there. It's not going to be in any significant quantity to cause really significant infection.
Any thoughts on that as well?
No, I agree. I mean, that there is that's a very small chance. Okay. The real question is a different one.
Okay.
Is smoking and or vaping predisposing you to risks of severe COVID-19 disease? I don't have an answer to this question right now, but I believe that's an important question. The other question is, you may remember, I don't know, but last September, like July through September, there was a new disease described with vaping, which was called EVALI, the acute lung injury from vaping, that actually caused serious disease, and we had patients as well here on ventilators. And the question now is interesting, because some of these EVALI patients look like COVID-19 patients from a lung disease point of view. And so what are we mixing here? And the answer to that question has not been answered, but we know that people have been thought to have COVID-19 and it turns out to have actually vaping-related lung injury. And there could be patients, obviously, that have both, and we don't know that.
So, Dr. Olinger, we know that a big population of vapers are kids, teenagers, kids heading back to school. So you have a different concern related to vaping in teenagers. Tell us about that.
Right. So, good morning. Thanks for having me. I just wanted to make sure that people are aware that adults usually vape and smoke on a personal and private level. But for kids and adolescents, vaping is a highly social event. It's something that they'll get together to do. Adults don't get together just to smoke, but kids do. And it's something that they enjoy doing together and showing off their vape clouds and trying different flavors. And my concern with that is that in the past, I've seen infections transferred from one kid to another through vaping. So about last fall, we had some kids in different school districts show up, and several of them, unfortunately, to our facilities for mental health crisis. But they were telling me that a lot of kids at our school have mono, and we're linking it back to actually using vapes and sharing vapes. So I've been telling them since that time, like, you know, you wouldn't share your straw with somebody whenever they're sick, right? But you should consider your vape as well as a vector of passing information and infection, excuse me, passing from one person to another. So it's something that is that I continue to tell kids every day, that if they're sharing their vapes with other people, they're at risk of sharing infection as well.
So it's the perfect storm. You have lots of kids congregating together and then mm-hmm. possibly.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And you don't wear a mask whenever you're vaping. That's the other thing too. They're in close proximity. They're not wearing a mask. And so that alone increases their risk of infection, but also they're passing one thing to another that they're breathing through.
And not even thinking about it. Okay, so why we have you here, I do have to ask you though, we're talking about kids and vaping. How do we get kids to kick this habit? Do you have any quick advice for parents or teens to get off the vape?
I think the big issue for kids is recognizing that it can cause harm. So there's still a belief because they don't see the actual impact at that time. It's hard for them to recognize that there's a problem. And we can tell them all that we want that this is something that's going to be harmful to them in the future. But unless they see it right now, it's hard to consider that. So I see a lot of patients who say to me, you know, I used to be able to run longer. I used to be able to play harder. And since I've been vaping, that's something that has been limited. So I share that with other people. I also let them know, have you noticed that you're coughing a little bit more? Does that bother you? And how much does this cost you? It's another thing. Teens aren't making a ton of money, and this stuff is expensive. And so letting families know that their pediatricians, their medical providers are here for them to help them through this process. There are fantastic ways to work through quitting. It's just opening a space for conversation to get that started and making sure that people are talking to their kids about this and making sure that they know that this is a medical problem just like any other problem that they can talk to their doctors about.
Which brings us back to Dr. Salathe. You've been talking about the research and the long-term effects that kids don't see today. They just might see 20 years from now, right?
Yes. In terms of vaping, especially with nicotine, which is the additive that makes you addicted to it, mm-hmm. right? So these vapes were really invented, I guess, for smokers who wanted to quit and have a better way of delivering nicotine to their brain without the adversity of the tobacco smoke. However, you know, that's always an interesting thought mm-hmm. because what can you really inhale that is not toxic? Mm-hmm. And I think the more we understand now, it's not only that the nicotine is actually toxic to your airways, because vaping is not geared to make nicotine easily absorbed into the bloodstream, so the airway sees much more nicotine. But also, we have now new data on the propylene glycol and the vegetable glycerin that you use for vaping and make the cloud for vaping. And those substances are actually not innocuous on the airway cells either. So we're creating sort of a perfect storm. And what you just said in terms of coughing, you know, sputum production, not being able to exercise as much as before, these are pretty bad signs of potential changes in your lungs, especially in young people. You know, we actually know that some of the research that has been done, and that is not quite out yet, but to look at how your airways are cleared from the mucus that you usually clear every day, in people who vape, this is severely reduced. And actually, interestingly, in the same age group who smokes, it is not. So that should be an alarm sign for people. You know, that we're potentially developing a whole generation with lung disease now from vaping. And people don't believe that. You know, teenagers are invulnerable. They don't think there is any danger. But these points that you mentioned with coughing, etc., that should raise the bar of alert.
We're going to get into some community questions and open up the conversation. I did just want to ask Dr. Olinger another quick question, though. Are there any other issues right now that are of a concern to you with teenagers, especially as we're heading back to school? I just wanted to open that up to find out if there's anything else that we should be aware of or on high alert for.
Mm-hmm. So I think going back into school, kids are going to have more opportunity to congregate and share vapes. So one of the unfortunate benefits of the pandemic and quarantine is that kids have not been together. And that has been detrimental to some kids' mental health and why we're seeing higher numbers in our facility than we usually do at this time of year. But when we go back into school, that provides more opportunity for kids to go right back to sharing things that they shouldn't be sharing that contact their mouths.
All right, thank you for that. Let's see if the media has any questions today. Nope. All right, Jill, what do you got from the community?
All right, so Kim wants to know, she was very interested in the Remdesivir, mm-hmm. and she wants to know what was it created for and how was it used prior to mm-hmm. starting to use it for COVID patients?
Yeah, I believe, you know, so Remdesivir is a product of Gilead, I believe. And I believe it was just one of the products that they came up with as an antiviral. Because of the way it works, obviously. And then I think they tried it with Ebola, and it didn't have a lot of success, and so they still had it. I'm not sure if it was around before Ebola, if they tried it with SARS or not, but I believe that's where it came from. So it has been around for a while, and it has been studied in other diseases such as Ebola. I could be wrong on some of those details, but ultimately, it has been around a little bit. It has been trialed in other diseases, and kind of this is where it has found some success.
Melissa is asking, what about the FLA 1000 treatment for coronavirus? Is that, yeah. am I saying it correctly? Is she?
Is it an acronym? Is it?
Yeah, it says FLA like Florida. Okay. 1000. Do you
sure.
have any idea what she's...
To...
So Melissa, write and tell us more so we can try to answer that question.
We need to know.
As far as treatments, though, we really only have four real treatments for COVID-19 disease, and that is Remdesivir. That has good studies showing some efficacy, in especially in certain populations. Obviously, we have steroids. Dexamethasone is the specific one. Anticoagulation, which is not treatment of the virus per se, but helping against some of the problems that arise with the virus, and that is all of the blood clotting. And then, of course, convalescent plasma or serum from recovered people. So there are still trials going on with all of those, including the plasma and Remdesivir as well. But those are the four mainstays of treatment right now.
And this is a molecule that is being developed that Melissa must refer to. But there's so many right now.
Yeah.
There are enormous numbers of molecules that people would like to try in COVID-19 mm-hmm. patients. Some of this has a problem because the good news is we don't really have enough patients for all of these molecules. I think that's a good piece that we don't have enough patients. So there are concerted efforts, especially from the NIH and other places, to really group those trials and make them multi-center clinical trials through large networks so we get the data we need to actually decide whether it's working or not.
And I know you doctors are going to love this because I'm doing this program with you and we're closing in on our 100th episode, but we have an opportunity to answer again for Donnie, who wants to know, I'm seeing reports that hydroxychloroquine mm-hmm. with zinc mm-hmm. is effective therapy. Is there any evidence this works?
I'm giving a straight answer. The answer is no.
Yeah.
Period. There is a retrospective study that sort of re-initiated mm-hmm. this discussion, but there are lots of flaws. All the prospective studies show no real efficacy. So the answer is no.
Yeah, I would certainly echo that. The answer is no. No real efficacy and also possible detriment. We have to understand that when this first started becoming in the mainstream media, when COVID started first coming, there were benchtop or basic science research studies. And again, that's where we start everything for treatments and vaccines and whatnot. that showed possible reduction in viral replication in vero cells, which are, I believe, kidney cells. So we don't even have that. We don't even replicate those. We are concerned really about the respiratory. And I think when they went back and did it and looked, tried to see if it reduced it in respiratory epithelial cells, that didn't even work. So that's where it started, and it's kind of ballooned from there. Since that time, we have had very good prospective studies looking at any efficacy of using hydroxychloroquine alone or with azithromycin, and neither of them showed efficacy, but almost possible detriment. So we really need to put this argument to bed right now. I don't think it's helping the United States. I don't think it's helping society, and I don't think it's helping the battle against COVID.
I was wondering where that question came from again, because I remember you answering this 3 months ago.
Mm-hmm. It continues to be brought up, but, you know.
Yeah, and we have new viewers all the time.
Where is that information? It's concerning when you have information coming in, you know, that you have said, you know, this is not effective, and then people are unfortunately getting this bad information out there, so it's good to remind.
And I wouldn't take it if I had COVID-19. I wouldn't take it to protect against COVID-19. We had very good studies, the HERO study, you know, that's being done with Dr. Castro here. He's one of our investigators on that. We've had good prospective studies about protection or prophylaxis against COVID, and it hasn't shown any benefit. In addition, you know, I wouldn't give it to myself. I wouldn't give it to my family. So I think that should be important.
Thanks
as well
for clearing that up, just if the bad info is still swirling around.
Yep.
So, Jill?
Yeah, so Taylor wants to know, earlier there were concerns about teen suicide during the pandemic. She's wondering where that is at, and she's also asking, do you test teens for COVID when they're admitted at Marillac, and are you getting positive patients?
Dr. Olinger?
So yes, we've definitely seen an increase in suicidality, unfortunately, in the pandemic. And I think that it goes back to the isolation that patients are experiencing. We see an increase, unfortunately, in domestic violence, which leads to worsened depression. So we have had higher numbers than we would expect in the summer. And I'm hoping that going back to school, we're all hoping that going back to school and having more socialization will be a protective factor from a mental health standpoint. In terms of COVID testing, our facility is doing this on a very individualized basis. So as a hospital system, generally, we do universal screening for anybody who's admitted to the facility. But for behavioral health, we're taking it case by case. We ask the patients if they have had any known exposure to COVID. We also ask them if they are symptomatic or having any risk factors that might be concerning for this. And if not, we're using our appropriate protective gear for every patient. We're asking them to wear masks and making sure that they're appropriately distancing during their admission here, but we are not universally screening at this time. But it is still something that in the future, as our numbers grow in the community, it's still definitely on the table of something we might potentially do.
But I think that's a good conversation to bring up, because that was a big concern at Marillac, was that parents were delaying care for their kids and getting them help because they were concerned about COVID. Mm-hmm. And so we just want to reiterate that it is safe, and that your kids' mental health and safety supersedes everything, so that it is safe to bring them to Marillac, correct?
And as an addition, every patient that is admitted to our facility gets a physical exam from the general pediatrics team. That's my team. This is our exam room. You'll notice my Star Wars. This is a very safe place for them to come in and get a full physical exam, where we make sure that their body is both physically able to participate in their mental health treatment while they're here, but also we're screening for infection from the time that they walk in, and then additionally whenever they do their physical exam with us.
Good. Keeping them healthy. Is it Dr. Seitz that loves Star Wars?
Yes.
Okay. He'd be sad. Star Trek. Okay.
Oh, he loved my exam room.
He'd love that anyway. Okay. Jill, next question.
Okay. So Kim has a question. It's sort of multi-parted, and it may or may not have some assumptions that may need clarifying, okay? So our question is, can you ask the doctors this morning why testing numbers, and she goes, and therefore positive cases, in Johnson County look to have dropped significantly since the weekend? Are people just not testing anymore, so our gating criteria will look okay? Is there a lag? What is going on? She's afraid that If this isn't accurate, the spread in our community will affect the capacity in which schools can open.
What are your thoughts, Dr. Hawkinson?
And I'm curious, I want to just add on to her question. Does this have anything to do with the change in reporting to CDC and now to HHS?
It should not have anything to do with the change in the reporting. Her question is very good because we have seen that in countries that have started school back, as she has stated and other people have stated, it's imperative that there is a low amount of community spread, and that's based on how many cases per capita per 100,000 people. And that obviously then links to testing. From what I understand, on the weekends, we always see a lag in the reporting just because it is a weekend, Saturday, Sunday. So I believe that's what it is. And KDHE will continue to update their testing sites with that. But for the most part, I don't think we've really seen a true lag in the cases. It's just on the data reporting side of that.
Bob, we see a flattening of the numbers of cases, at least in the KC metro area, which is good news, right? And I always say, let's look at the census of hospitals of COVID-19 mm-hmm. patients. That gives us an indication. Although, you know, if younger people have it, maybe there is less admissions to the hospital. Mm-hmm. But as long as our census is not, you know, going up drastically, we're probably in a reasonable spot. That doesn't mean for school opening necessarily, but for our general public, we're not in a bad spot.
So testing up, but cases down? I'm just trying to clarify. We're saying
testing is not different, but the testing, we still have a high percentage positives.
We do.
Which is a concern.
Okay. Yeah, and certainly, you know, Secretary Norman said, and it's up there on the KDHE website, it's about 9%. So 9% of tests that we do are positive, which is up from a few months ago, and it has been steadily climbing. But hopefully it will stay at that level and ultimately decrease, because then if we see that flattening or the decrease in the curve, then it will seem as if it's safer to get back to schools.
All right. So we have a person that is asking that she is taking hydroxychloroquine for lupus and wants to know if she got sick, would that prevent her from taking Remdesivir?
No.
Yeah.
The answer is no.
Okay.
Because I think, Jill, that was a question that we get a lot, is if you take one treatment, does that, or if you go into one trial, does that bump you out for a different trial?
Well, trials are different, but if you get treatment, then that's not an issue. If you go into a specific treatment trial, there are two issues. The best treatment trials are actually placebo-controlled, meaning you may not get the real treatment to find out whether it actually works. That's one thing. And the other piece is that then there are usually restrictions on additional treatments in that area, because otherwise it's difficult to actually assess which really worked. But in this case, it's if it's not a treatment trial, that's not a concern.
Yeah.
Lindsay wants to know, is there a common denominator that leads patients to have to be put on a ventilator? Is it basically they do not respond to the initial treatment, or have they waited too long to go to the hospital, or have underlying conditions, weight, nationality, age?
Mm-hmm. Well, so yes and no. It depends on a lot of things. I think when we started this program, I said the time of putting people on ventilators have changed a little bit. So we're trying now much more to keep them off a ventilator with other modes of supporting their respiratory system. And that's high flow oxygen and other ways of trying to help you breathe with a decrease in your work of breathing. So that has changed. And so it's really depending on how sick you are from a pulmonary point of view. And it's not necessarily depending on whether if you come late, then you're sicker. That doesn't mean we would have been able to prevent it. Yeah. We still have a really hard time to predict who is doing poorly and who is not doing poorly. Yeah.
What are you saying, Dr. Hawkinson?
Yeah, absolutely. We know that there are those risk factors, and we've talked about them since March. And it's age, obviously, above 65 especially, weight, diabetes, heart disease, lung disease, other immunocompromising conditions. So that puts you in a higher risk category for having the propensity to progress to critical illness and ventilators. Obviously, we have tried to not have you on the ventilator if possible. If you otherwise meet the criteria, such as a certain time frame from your symptom onset, you are still going to be eligible for those treatments such as remdesivir, steroids, anticoagulation. But unfortunately, there are people in their 20s, 30s, 40s who don't have any of those underlying conditions. Their risk is lower, but they still do end up in the ICU and on the ventilator and with a risk of death. We don't exactly know why and how that happens. There is research coming out weekly that hopes to elucidate that, and taking that information as well as the information from SARS and MERS, and also with the other information from the endemic or the common cough and cold coronavirus as well. But for the most part, it is those main risk factors of age, weight, diabetes, heart disease that really put you at the higher risk for having to go to critical illness, the ICU, and being on the ventilator.
So Melissa was a victim of autocorrect, and she wants to know if this makes a difference. Okay. It wasn't FLA 1000. She was asking about RLF hyphen 100 aviptadil. Still not. All right, we'll look it up.
We will look it up.
We'll investigate that.
We'll look it up.
Moving on to Ruthie. She wants to know, how reliable are the tests that show results within 90 minutes, and are they testing for active virus or antibodies?
Good question.
Some active virus, almost no tests for active virus, because active virus would mean that you have to take the sample and put it on cells and see whether there's replication. Yeah. So most tests are commonly used. They're called PCR tests. They look for the genetic material of the virus in the secretions. So that's the most common test. But that doesn't mean it's an active virus. We don't know that
Correct.
For sure. Several of the very quick tests look for what we call antigens. You know, these are specific pieces of the virus that are recognized by antibodies. So there are more and more developments in that space. Many of them are not yet quite as good as that we really want them to be. But we're going to get better, I'm hoping, over the next few months.
Yeah, I mean, if we can get an efficient, accurate PCR test, which is, again, looking for the genomic material, as Dr. Salathe had talked about, we don't know if that's active virus. Obviously, if you're having symptoms, we would assume that it's active virus. If it is 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks out, and you are still testing positive, by the way, we don't really advocate for retesting once you've tested positive and have had symptoms, then that's probably just the genomic material and not live virus. But certainly some of those tests, when they look for the genomic material, they can be as short as 90 minutes possibly, but that does take preparation time for these tests. The antigen tests that Dr. Salathe was talking about, hopefully we can get those. We would like to have accurate ones, you know, where everybody can access them, just like influenza tests. Right now, they really don't meet criteria, but hopefully moving forward through all this, we'll be able to develop those accurate tests so that we can get everybody tested when they need to be and want to be tested to try and cut down the spread of diseases.
Are those the rapid tests like we were talking about with Dr. Norman?
Some of those
yesterday?
Are rapid tests,
like, so we can get kids back to school and get them tested quick.
Go safely on an airplane.
Yeah,
airplane,
absolutely.
School, go all the places we want to go. Jill?
Exactly.
Vicki wants to know, she says CNN announced this morning that vaccine may not work as well on obese individuals. Any truth to that? About what makes the vaccine work in different people?
You know, we understand that certainly there are risk factors of sometimes vaccines not taking or not causing an immune reaction as well as in other people. Now, luckily, with the vaccines that have already on the market, we understand that they have had a lot of testing behind them. So until we really get the new vaccine data on all the different population groups, we really won't understand that. We know that certain conditions, like I said, cause some vaccines, such as if you have liver cirrhosis and we give you vaccines, or you have HIV and we give you vaccines and you don't have the CD4 counts to mount an immune response, then certainly they are less effective. So this is not a new finding. Again, with this information and where we are at being so new, we are still going to be evaluating all of that. And are all these other populations, such as people who are otherwise immunosuppressed or maybe who are obese, will the vaccine not take, or will it not cause an immune response as well as in other populations? That could possibly be true. I think it's still very early, though, and we need to kind of wait for the full studies.
But I think there is one other piece of information that's important. Even if a person doesn't respond well to the vaccine, if we get herd immunity with vaccine, right, in the flu season, the most effective, actually, vaccinations is with school children, where the spread occurs. If we can eliminate the spread, it may not be that important that you are personally vaccinated efficiently, but that actually the community is, and then there is no spread, and you are protected from disease as well.
Linda has an interesting question. She says, do people that have mild cases and they're never hospitalized still go on to have heart, lung, kidney damage?
Yeah.
We've heard that.
We don't know. I mean, we really don't have long-term follow-up studies that we know that for sure. It's less likely, the less severe you are in terms of disease, that you have long-term consequences, but we don't know that for sure. There's studies going now on the way, too.
And we know from some recent publications on the heart, although I don't believe people really had symptoms, they could see MRI changes. So is it functionally important? Who knows? We know that and understand that people who are asymptomatic, these are some from the early studies out of China, showing that even if you were asymptomatic, had no symptoms whatsoever, you had CT scan or CAT scan changes in your lung as well. Now, how functionally important is that, and that will that make you be short of breath or not be able to do the activities? We don't understand that. Those studies are ongoing, and hopefully we'll learn some more about that.
Another great question from Sarah. I probably have a different level of what I think is a great question and what you guys think is a great question, but as doctors. But just as a mom, Sarah says, I have more than one friend who has tested positive and has symptomatic young children, but the pediatrician says, they probably have it, just keep them quarantined. No need to get them tested. She's wanting to know, does that skew the numbers? Is that important?
Well,
if it skews the numbers?
Sure, it skews the numbers. If you don't test, you don't know what the cases are. And I'm not subscribing to the idea, don't test so we don't know the cases.
Right.
But it also depends on the availability of testing.
Yes.
And I think that's the more important piece.
Yeah, absolutely important. You know, we understand, and the CDC has even come out and said when there was 2 million or 2.5 million cases in the United States, well, we anticipate there's maybe up to 10 or 20 million of cases that don't go diagnosed. So I think as far as the testing capacity, and if you're not going to get the results for 3 or 5 days, then it's probably not useful to test. We're not saying don't test because of skewing the numbers, but just because of the practicality of that. Instead, what is better is isolating at home and keeping people away from everybody for that at least 10-day period.
Dr. Olinger, you were shaking your head. What are your comments and thoughts?
So our thoughts, KU Pediatrics is happy to test anybody who feels that it is needed for their child, especially if your child is symptomatic or they've been around somebody who's symptomatic, especially if they've been around somebody who's a known COVID positive. We want to make sure that families are aware that even if you're not established, if you're not an established patient at KU Pediatrics, we have open doors to make sure that your child gets the care that they need and so that you know their diagnosis if it's present.
All right, thank you for that. Okay, so we want to get everyone's final thoughts, and we really thank our panel for being on today. Jill, did you have one more question, though?
Yeah.
Yes,
can we
I saw your hand
more?
Go up.
Okay, because I have a lot of people asking the same questions, and I think that earlier there was talk about from some people at the national level about you should wear masks indoors. People are asking, should you wear masks outdoors? Mary's got book club tonight. She's wanting to know, we're meeting outside, wear a mask, don't wear a mask.
Yeah.
Look, can you just speak to mask wearing before we sign off today?
Yeah, I'll let Dr. Salathe.
Okay, we'll have Salathe
take the
start
floor.
And it's all you. Okay, what is your message about masking?
When in doubt, wear a mask. You know, that's basically what it is. Indoors, for sure, unless you're at home with your loved ones, and that's a different situation. But otherwise, indoors, no question. And it has been shown it really helps. That's mm-hmm. good. Outside, if you're not sort of standing alone on a field and shouting at each other from afar, wear a mask. You know, there's nothing wrong of wearing a mask. And it's easier in a book club, right? Even if you think you do distancing, there's a group of people, maybe you get closer, maybe there's not much wind, and it's just a higher risk. So why take the risk?
And you're talking, lots of talking.
That's right.
Yeah, mm-hmm. So, okay, drive home the mask message.
Yeah.
What are your thoughts?
Try to continue to stay physically distanced. And again, you don't know where those people have been in the bubble. Obviously, we don't really endorse wearing masks if you're exercising and with activity. That will be very hard. Not for gas exchange. You have plenty of gas exchange in any of the cloth or surgical masks. It's more because of the heat is certainly uncomfortable. But in those situations, if you don't really know who's in everybody else's bubble, if you can't really maintain 8 or 10 feet away, I know that normally we say 6, but certainly we've always promoted 8, 10 feet or more. It may not be a bad thing to do.
When in doubt, wear a mask. I like that. Mm-hmm. Ending with that. That's such a great message. Okay, so Dr. Olinger, any thoughts on mask wearing? And I'd just like to get your final thoughts and what message you really want all of us to take away today.
So from a mask wearing perspective, our communication to our pediatric population is if you are within 2 dolphin lengths of the next person, you need to have a mask on. And that's something that kids are able to visualize in a fun way and make it something that it's not scary, but we want them to be safe, and that's what it's all about. And then from a final thought standpoint, just making sure that people know that vaping is a way. If you share your vape with somebody, you can share an infection. So please be aware, please talk to your children, and feel free to contact your pediatrician or your medical provider to seek care, because we have great resources to help families who are dealing with this epidemic.
So much for being with us today. You shared a really great message, very important. We really appreciate it. Want to let everyone know about tomorrow's show. We have another vital organization and the people that it serves feeling like they're really taking the brunt of COVID-19. Vibrant Health CEO Patrick Salathe is going to join us. He says that unemployment in Wyandotte is 14%. It was 3.8% back in March. So Sally will be updating us on this kind of trickle-down effect that we're seeing of job loss combined with the high rate of infection rates in Wyandotte. So we'll talk with him. Thank you both, our doctors here, for being with us on set. Dr. Salathe, what are your final thoughts today?
My final thoughts.
Just for today.
So for today.
Not in general.
We are in a terrible time from that infection point of view. But I think we have learned, we know how we can stop the spread of that virus. Mm-hmm. We know how we can live with the virus right now. And we know that likely, highly likely, very effective vaccines are coming very soon. So I would like to appeal to everyone. Let's ride it out safely. Mm-hmm. You know, let's have the last few months of this, hopefully, pandemic, and do the right thing to stop the spread of virus. That will bring us at least partially back to a more normal life until the vaccines are here. But we don't need to exacerbate it. We can control it, so let's do it. Yeah. Takes everyone.
Your optimism only works if we do it right.
So that's right.
Thank you. We like that. Okay, so Dr. Hawkinson,
thoughts from
you today?
I'll just take Dr. Salathe's quote, when in doubt, wear a mask. Because we do have to live with it. We're not in a post-COVID world. We are in a COVID world right now. We all want to get back to doing the things that we want to do, meeting with friends, book clubs, not having to be outside, but indoors, going to stadiums, seeing those things. So please, everybody, wear your mask and social distance. And as far as that other topic goes, we'll try to get the answer to that. I don't know if maybe it was the Eli Lilly. Eli Lilly has just launched, I believe, a phase 3 for a monoclonal antibody, which is one single antibody to an epitope, probably the spike protein. It's to the spike protein of coronavirus. They are launching a clinical trial for that. And if that proves to be effective, that's going to be one more thing that we use in our group of treatments for this COVID disease. So.
Thank you both. We appreciate this. Okay, so we got a cool video coming up in just a second, but remember to keep sending us your pictures of how you're wearing masks, how you're being safe in the community and social distancing. Here's a couple ways you can send us those photos right there on your screen. Include a little bit about yourself, too, who's in the photo and what you're out doing. We love seeing those. Okay, so Dr. Seitz, he's back tomorrow. And as we say goodbye this morning, we're going to leave you with this viral YouTube video. This is Alabama principal Quentin Lee. He's channeling his inner MC Hammer. And I know that he's probably been waiting, what, 30 years since this song came out to try to find a way to weave it into his life and make this video. And it's really driving home, really, these safety measures that we've been talking about for months now, certainly as we head back to school. So enjoy this. Have a great day. And we'll see you tomorrow.
Can't touch this. You can't touch this. You can't touch this. Can't touch this. My coronavirus hits me so hard. All the teachers say, oh my Lord, COVID is stressing me. All the updates from the CDC, Lysol can't be found. I've looked all around this town. I've had no luck. And these are the things you can't touch. I told you, students, you can't touch this. You better pull that mask up. You can't touch this. It's the CDC, not me. You can't touch this. Hey, don't wash your hands. You can't touch this. Fresh new rules and plans. Let's all be safe. Go wash your hands. So move back up 6 feet. You better not cough and you better not sneeze. Sanitation. Hold on, let me check your temp. Not under your arm like that. Like that, you're all clear, go to the back. Everybody says that this is too much, and these are the things that you can't touch. Yo, I told you. You can't touch this. Why are y'all standing so close? Back up. You can't touch this. Every time you see me, Dr. Lee is sanitized. I'm gonna keep my hand clean, cause the cases are on the rise. Now why would I ever stop doing this? While others getting ill, I don't wanna be sick. I've been to all the classroom from upstairs into the gym. It's Lee, go Lee, Dr. Lee, yo doc, you're late. Look at the clock, can't touch this. Can't touch this. Break it down. Six feet. Sanitize.